lecture. Before doing that, let me quickly recapitulate the things that we did in the last class. We discussed the flyback converter, wherein I am using a transformer, only one coil is carrying current at a time. Okay. The transfer function to the flyback converter is given by V naught is equal to N2 by N1 into V in or VDC D divided by 1 minus D. One point to be remembered is that provided flux is continuous. Flux is continuous. Okay, this is a transfer function. But I also told you that generally flyback converter is operated in discontinuous. Maximum value is around 0.5 or so. Okay. So at that time, what could be the output voltage? One has to derive. Please remember, this transfer function is valid only if flux in the core is continuous. See, how did we derive this equation? We used volt second per turn balance. Okay, volt second per turn balance. So you said primary voltage applied to the primary is VDC. Okay. For dt seconds, and number of turns is n1. Okay, and we equated this equal to volt second per turn of the secondary. I said V out 1 minus d into t divided by n2. See, I am assuming that voltage applied to the secondary is V2 for 1 minus d into t seconds. That can happen only when diode is conducting in the secondary. See, in this circuit, dot current enters the dot, current should enter the dot now. So this is how it is. Okay. So switch is on for d into t seconds. Okay. And switch is turned on only after t seconds. It's like, you know, this is what I'm trying to tell you. D into t, and this is t. Second time is being turned on. So one from dt to t, voltage applied to the secondary is V naught, provided this diode is on. Okay. If the current becomes zero in the secondary before t, then this transfer function is not valid. This transfer function is not valid. Remember. Okay, I'll repeat. Voltage applied to the secondary is V naught only when diode D2 is conducting. And in case diode turns off before T, then volt second per turn for the secondary is not V naught into 1 minus D into T divided by N2. So you have to find out where the diode turns off. Okay. So if it turns off somewhere here, then volt second per turn is beta into T minus D into T. Okay. Remember. So this equation I have derived neglecting the winding resistance, device drop. Okay. So if this device drop is comparable to the input voltage, say I have 12 volt solar panel and device drop is 2, then the 2 is comparable to 12. So we have to take care of this 2 volts. Similarly, here in the secondary. So all the non-idealities we need to take into account while determining the turns ratio. Okay. So if time permits, we will take one design problem. All those issues will be discussed. Similarly, for a forward converter as well, so in both forward converter as well as in flyback converter, I am using a transformer, but then if I see the BH characteristics, we are operating in the first quadrant itself. So in other words, the magnetics are not utilized fully. Can I use bidirectional core excitation, something similar to AC? Okay. So if I use bidirectional excitation is something similar to AC, therefore voltage induced in the secondary will have both positive half as well as negative half. Finally, we require a DC. So what we need to do? The voltage induced in the secondary, we need to rectify it and filter it to get a DC. Okay. Please try to understand, the moment I am using bidirectional excitation, voltage induced in the secondary is going to be AC because it will have positive half as well as a negative half. I want a DC. I have to rectify it and filter it. So why are we doing this? First, we are converting this DC to AC and again to DC. I did say that I am using a bidirectional excitation, but one thing that I didn't tell you is the switching frequency is very high, or the frequency of the voltage induced in the secondary is very high. So as the switching frequency increases, okay. So frequency of the voltage induced in the secondary also increases. So there are two advantages. One is size of the magnetics, the inductor or the transformer reduces. As the frequency increases, the number of turns come down. Second, I have to rectify this AC voltage to DC. As the frequency increases, the ripple frequency also increases. See, what I mean is, if I take say full wave rectifier, single full wave rectifier, it looks something like this. Okay, what is this? This is T by 2 and this is T by 2. So if I do, if the frequency is very high, so this, the frequency of this pulses also increases, so my filtering requirement comes down. So if I have a three phase, 6 pulse conversion, what will happen? I will have something like this. So my filtering requirement in this case is much less compared to filtering requirement here. Okay. So what I will do is I will convert this DC to high frequency AC. Magnitude is determined by the application. So number of turns will be, okay, magnitude will be determined by the application, frequency is very high, I will convert it into DC, then I will use a very small filter to filter out the ripple and get a constant DC, that is the philosophy. Okay. So first one in this class is push-pull converter, the circuit configuration is here, see the transformer connection, I have a center tap. And at the secondary, you just see it is nothing but a center tap full wave rectifier. Okay. This circuit would have seen in while fabricating a regulated power supply in the lab, something like this. Sorry. It looks something like this. This is what we did to get a a 5 volt DC in the lab, what we did? A diode and diode capacitor. This is what we did. And we connected to, you see. So the secondary here, what this does? It rectifies. This is the filter. Something similar one here. There is no difference at all. See the secondary. Okay. This is the filter. Where did we see this stage? This filtering stage? In buck converter. Buck converter. See in the primary side. I have two switches and see the connections. A center type primary, center type secondary. T1 and T2 are two switches. VDC is the supply voltage. Here it could be voltage from the solar panel through a capacitive filter or whatever. Okay. See the dot conventions. Let us see how it works. Now, from 0 to dt by 2, the first half T1 is on. When I close T1, this is the path, positive, this is the direction of current. Current enters the dot. Let us see what happens in the secondary. If current enters the dot, current can leave the dot. So, yes, current can leave the dot. D1 can conduct. Can D2 conduct? No. So, when T1 is turned on, current enters the dot, current can leave the dot, so therefore D1 conducts. So, what is the path? D1, secondary, the filtering stage, back to here. So, what is the voltage applied to the N1 turns? It is VDC. So, the corresponding there will be voltage induced in the secondary with the dot as positive. And that will force the current in the secondary. Okay. After some time, open T1. Okay. See here, voltage across N1 is equal to V11, that is nothing but VDC with the dot as positive. Okay. Now this dot is positive and this dot also will be positive. So what is the voltage rating of T2? You just trace the circuit. VDC. Okay. Positive of the VDC is connected to one terminal T2, negative here to the positive of the voltage source which is induced, or positive voltage source which is induced in N12 with the dot as positive. I am calling that voltage as V12. If N11 is equal to N12, in fact they are the same. The voltage induced here will be VDC itself. So, this is the voltage T2. Okay. So, similarly, what is the voltage induced in D2 when D1 is conducting? Same concept we need to see. This is positive, this is positive. Voltage induced in N21 is proportional to the number of turns in the supply voltage. Similarly, N22. Trace the circuit, positive, positive, D1 is on, the entire voltage D2 has to block. So, voltage across D2 is 2 VDC N2 by N1, voltage across T2 is 2 VDC. So, voltage rating of the switches is 2 VDC. After some time, open T1. Okay. This. Now, what happens in the secondary? The moment T1 is on, D1 is positive. After some time, open T1. What will happen? So this is the duration from 0 to t is equal to 0 to t by 2. T1 is on, T2 is off. From dt by 2 to t by 2, see here, dt by 2 to t by 2, I am saying T1 and T2 are off. I am not saying anything about the secondary. From dT by 2 to T by 2, both T1 and T2 are off. What happens in the secondary, we will see. From T by 2 to 1 plus D into T into T by 2, T2 is on, T1 is off. And from this period to T, both T1 and T2 are off. Nothing has been mentioned about what happens in the secondary. Okay? N11 is equal to N12 and N21 is equal to N22. Okay? So, when I close T1, current enters the dot, current can leave the dot in the secondary. So, therefore, primary current I1 has two components. One is the magnetizing current plus the equivalent secondary current. Okay? Now, when I open T1, what happens? One, there should be a path for the magnetizing flux or the magnetizing current, and there should be a path for the inductor current as well, IL. Okay? While discussing forward or flyback, what we found that when the, if the current enters the dot, the correct direction, the polarity for the magnetizing flux to be continuous is current should enter the dot in some other winding. I will repeat, the correct direction is for the magnetizing current if current enters the dot, current should enter dot even in the secondary or even whichever winding. Same thing is in the in forward as well. This is what we did, VDC. Current enters the dot, current leaves the dot. So, these two windings carry current simultaneously. So, the source current or the primary winding current has two components, magnetizing current plus the equivalent secondary current. Okay? So, when I open S, if current enters the dot, current can enter the dot here. So, this is the correct direction or direction for the magnetizing current. Current should enter the dot. Something similar, same principle is applicable everywhere. Even here, if current enters the dot, current should enter the dot even in some other winding. By the way, T2 is not closed. So, what happens in the secondary, you just see. See in the second half. So, current can enter the dot. If current enters the dot, D2, it can flow through D2. But then here, if the moment D2 starts conducting, okay, D1 also starts conducting. D1 also starts conducting. See, the, what will happen to the flux linkages in these two windings, you need to check. The moment D2 starts conducting, D1 also will start conducting. D1 also starts conducting. Okay? So, this is the equivalent circuit. I2 enters the dot, ID1 can leave the dots. If D2 conducts, D1 also can conduct. See, I2 enters the dot. These two are mutually coupled. Can, if I2, whatever, ID2 can enter the dot, some current can leave the dot. ID1 can leave the dot. Yes, D1 can leave the dot. Is bit tricky here. Just try to understand in this circuit. Nothing, no current can flow in the primary because both the switches are off. When I close the switch, no current can flow through D2 because dot is positive. Okay, voltage, twice the supply voltage appears, twice the supply voltage into the number of turns will appear across D2. So, D2 has to block that voltage. When I open the switch, correct direction for the magnetizing current is, since it's enter the dot in the primary, it should enter the dot in any winding which is mutually coupled. Yes, it can enter the dot here, but then if it enters the dot here, it can leave the dot, can leave the dot here, so because of D21. So therefore, both D1 and D2 are on. Okay, and this is the equivalent circuit. Both D1 and D2 are on. Okay. Now, see, this is what this is the equivalent circuit. N22 into D5 by dt is the voltage induced here. Similarly, N21 d5 by dt is the voltage here. R is the winding resistance of these two coils. This is the equivalent. Okay. Now, can we write the voltage equations? These are the two voltage, N21 d5 by dt minus id1 into R1 is equal to VO1. Okay. This is the voltage VO1, and that voltage is also equal to N22 d5 by dt plus ID2 into R is equal to minus VO1. Voltages are same, therefore, if I equate it, I get this equation. So, if ID2 minus ID1, of course, ID2 should be greater than ID1. Why? The magnetizing current can flow only through this. So, ID2 should be greater than ID1. So, this is the voltage equation. Average voltage across L is equal to 0. VO1 is equal to 0. So, voltage induced will be 0. So, this is how it looks. T1 on for D into T, D to T by 2. In this period, both are off. So if the flux is continuous, both D1 and D2 are on here. Both the diodes are on. Okay. Oh, that is the reason. See here. IL1 is the inductor current. When T1 is on, IL is the current that is flowing through D1. Same current. The moment you turn off T1, okay, T1 current becomes 0, current flowing through D1 also falls to approximately 50%. And correspondingly, current through D2 also rises. This is how the current waveforms. Okay. So at T by 2, what happens after T by 2? I will turn on T2. Okay. So when I turn on T2, what happens in the primary? This is the path. Current leaves the dot. If current can leave the dot, current should enter the dot. Not possible here, this is the path. See, please don't get intimidated. Only principle that you need to understand is, you need to know is mutually coupled circuit. Yes, it is not very straightforward. But then if you can understand this dot convention, it becomes relatively simpler. So if current enters the dot, current should leave the dot if there is a path. If there is no path, when I open the switch, if current enter the dot, current should enter the dot in some other winding. That's all. Only those concepts one need to remember. Okay. So when I close the switch, current leaves the dot, N22. When I open T2, I have not closed T1, we have to wait for some time. I said in this period none of the switches T1 and T2 are off, 1 plus D into T by 2 to 2 to T, T1 and T2 are off, something similar to DT by 2 to T by 2, both T1 and T2 are off. The transfer function is, you can derive it as 2 VDC N2 divided by N1 into D. Why? So, this is, I said this is nothing but a forward, a buck converter. When T1 is on, D1 is on. So, this is a buck converter with the forcing function of VDC into N21 divided by N11. When I open the switch, we proved that this voltage is 0. Okay. So, this is nothing but the output stage, or this is nothing but the equivalent circuit of the buck converter when you open the switch. So, the transfer function is only for one winding is VDC into N21 divided by N11 into D. Something similar happens for these two windings as well. Okay. So, a factor 2, 2 VDC N2 by N1 into D, nothing but an isolated buck converter, isolated buck converter. Okay. Quite popular if the power rating is around 1 to 1.5 kilowatt or 2 kilowatt or so. Okay. So, above 700 to 800 watts, one has to go in for the push-pull converter, okay, wherein I am using both halves of the magnetic circuits. So, what are the limitations of the push-pull converter? See, I told you both windings are number of turns in both the halves is the same, N11 is equal to N12, N21 is equal to N22. What will happen if they are not the same? They change by a fraction. Primary winding may differ by a fraction of a turn. What will happen? See here, switches may have, switches may have a slightly different saturation voltage. So, this is the equivalent circuit. When I close T1, a dot is positive. So, maybe we are in the first half of the BH loop, okay, increasing flux. Okay. But then I said N11 is not equal to N12. Okay. There could be a, both the windings could change by a fraction. Or device drop may not be the same. If device drop is may not be the same, voltage applied to N11 is equal to VDC minus the drop across T1. Okay. That is being applied to the coil, which is having a small resistance plus the leakage. But then N12, voltage applied to N12 is VDC minus the voltage drop across T2. So, if there is a difference in the magnitude of the voltage applied to the coil, okay. So, therefore, if there is a difference in the voltage applied to this coil, so what will happen? d phi by dt. Okay, I will write this equation. I have something like this. Magnitude of voltages are not the same. Okay. They change, or there is a small difference, plus there is a number of turns also may not be the same. If they could change in a small fraction. If that is the case, what will happen? When I am here, I am in the first half. Here, I am in the third quadrant. Okay. So, what will happen? BH curve may not be traversed symmetrically. Okay. BH curve is not traversed symmetrically. If that is the case, a DC flux will exist in the core. Average is going to be finite. Average is going to be finite. The positive half is not equal to the negative half. Now there is average is finite. Average is nothing but the DC flux. Now if there is a DC flux, what may happen? Assume that there is a small DC flux, and in second or third cycle, load has changed, or say load has increased. Now the controller is trying to increase D. Okay. So as D increases, time for which T1 is on also increases. Okay. Now instead of starting from 0, since there is a DC flux, it starts from a finite value, switch is on for a longer time. Okay. Therefore, a DC voltage is applied to a winding for a longer time, flux and current increases, they cannot go on increasing linearly. After some time, core may get saturated. Okay. Or so that is one, core may get saturated. Second is, I have a core imbalance and what is known as a flux walking in one direction. There could be a gradual increase in flux. So that is also known as a flux walking in one direction. So these are the limitations of push pull. You need to ensure that both the windings have same number of turns. Okay. And third one is, if there is no dead time between these two, dead time in the sense there is before T1 turns off, you are turned on T2, what may happen? The flux produced by I1 opposes the flux produced by I2. Number of turns is the same. Okay. So the current is, so if the number of turns is the same, L1 is equal to L2, I am neglecting the leakage, of course, that is equal to the mutual. Okay. They cancel out, and now I is limited by the internal resistance itself. There could be a dead short circuit. Current is limited by a small r. So there has to be a dead time between T1 and T2. Okay. So these are the limitations of the push-pull converter. Load, okay, and I am assuming the current in the inductor is something like this. Okay. So under this condition, how does the current through S look like? Okay. D into T, this is T. At this point, again you are increasing. So whatever the current that was flowing through the diode just prior to T starts flowing through S. So current through S looks something like this. Okay. See the di by dt in of the current that is flowing through S. There is a large di by dt. We all know that in the initial, when the device is getting turned on, the entire area is not available for conduction. So you, if the di by dt exceeds the rating, because the hotspot device may fail. Okay. So a di by dt is very high. Also, if I see the voltage across the device when I turn on, it gradually falls. Okay. So therefore, during on time, voltage and current flowing through the device, voltage across the device and current flowing through the device are finite, and there is going to, the product is nothing but the power loss that is taking place in the device. Okay. So as the switching frequency increases, losses that are occurring in the device also increases. So therefore, the efficiency, point number one. Okay. So as the losses increases, your junction temperature also increases. And in a safe operating area, there is one area is always is limited by, or one of the boundaries is the junction temperature that one has to control. Second is the di by dt and dv by di by dt through the device is very high, okay. Therefore, there will be a EMI, electromagnetic interference, okay. It will produce its own field, try to affect the nearby the control circuit, okay. Can I try to address this limitations? So this sort of a switching is also known as hard switching. Why hard? I'm not bothering about what is the current flowing through the device at the instant of turn on. Okay, the whatever the pulses that are coming out from the controller are just passed on to this switch. Okay, so depending upon the current that is flowing through the inductor, the switch starts taking the current, starts carrying the current. Okay, so therefore, di by dt is very high. Plus, the voltage, the product of V and I during conduction is during the turn on is high, losses are high. Okay, so that is, so losses that are taking place in the device is one of the, it puts one of the limit on the switching frequency. So if I'm doing a hard switching, it may not be possible to switch this device at a very high frequency, though it is capable of switching at a very high frequency. See, I will repeat, if I am doing hard switching, in other words, I am just not bothered about what is the current that is flowing through the device at the instant of turn on, okay. Due to the power loss that is taking place and other effects, I may not be able to increase the switching frequency beyond a certain value, okay. So if I am in a hard switch converter, there is always, or in a hard switch converter, switching frequency is generally low. See, one of the question that was asked in one of the centers, sir, what is the switching frequency in a flyback converter? How am I supposed to answer that? I can't answer, I do not know. What sort of a switching is being used? Are you doing this hard switching? What is the power rating? What is the voltage rating? What sort of a device? Based on that, you can decide. So if you are using a flyback converter, power is of the order of 100 watt also, safely for hard switch converter, I can say around 25 kilohertz. First you try to operate at 25 kilohertz. You may not be able to do, because all the non-idealities, the parasitic capacitance, inductance, all those issues will come. It is very easy to make the circuit to work on a breadboard or on a table. The moment you start integrating it, the because of this EMI, okay, it will affect the control circuit. So you may not be able to increase beyond a certain value. So please, when I say that I do not know, you need to try to understand, it may not be possible to often tell you what could be the switching frequency. It all depends on what sort of a switching that you do, what sort of a device that you use, what is the voltage and power rate. So fine, if you want to start off with any design, take one, assemble the circuit. Start with a very conservative figure. If you are able to operate it, is fine. There are no problem. Then go on increasing the switching frequency. Don't have to take that value from me. I am no God, please. Okay, that's about it. Second is, now coming to the hard switching. Because of this hard switching, there are losses that are taking place. If the losses that are taking place, since I have to control the junction temperature, I have to use a bigger heat sink. Therefore, my size increases. Okay. Plus my cooling requirement, I may have to use a forced cooling as well, okay. Because of this hard switching, I cannot increase the switching frequency, though in principle this device is capable of operating at a high frequency. I will repeat, because of this hard switching, we may not be able to, it may not be possible to switch this device at a high frequency, though this device is capable of switching at a high frequency. Switching frequency may not be governed by the switch. Switching frequency may be limited by the way you are switching. The way you are switching. Can I try to address this issue? Yes, it is possible. Yeah, I will try to cover in my next lecture. It is 9:50. For 10 minutes or so, I will take up few questions.
Shastri University, Tanjore. Over to you.
Good morning, sir. Secondary of the push-pull amplifier behave like a full wave midpoint converter. In midpoint converter, at a time the two switches are not conduct. But after that, you told here at a time D1 and D2 conducts. How it's possible, sir? Please explain.
Please try Thank to you, understand sir. In what context that I have said. See, what is this? Tell me, secondary, what is this?
Secondary of the midpoint converter or rectifier.
What is this stage?
It is the rectifier circuit, sir.
Why am I doing this? Why am I using rectifier circuit in DC to DC conversion? So, I am here. When I turn on both T1 and T2, what happens? Direction of flux here increase in the positive direction. This was positive, now the dots are negative. I am using the both halves of the magnetic circuit. Okay. So what will happen? Voltage induced in the secondary has a positive half as well as a negative half. Finally, I want to have a DC to DC. I want to have a DC voltage here. What do I do? Filter it. Now your question is, yes, both the diodes are not conducting in full wave rectifier. Yes, here also it happens in the sense when switch S1 is on, only one diode is on. When both are off, primary is completely cut off. Don't directly relate to what happens in full or center tap transformer in AC to DC converter that you use in the lab. Now, when both the diodes are conducting, here neither T1 and T2 are on. Both these two are off. And if it so happens that in this case, if D1 starts conducting, D2 also will start conducting. You need to write the circuit. I wrote the circuit equation and it showed you. Please, in the sense, I explained to you because this, why did I say that this looks like a center tap transformer? Yes, it looks, does, in the sense secondary is, there are, it is a center tap, a full wave rectifier, center tap transformer. Why am I using this? Looks like voltage induced here is AC, I want to have DC, looks like. Now, I have told you the principle of operation. Now you go back and understand in your own way. Is that okay?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, no problem.
Government College, Salem. Over to you.
Sir, good morning. Sir, if I say, what do you mean? If you can say, sir, what do you mean by high power density converter? High power density DC to DC converter, if it means what it means, sir? High power density converter.
What is the foot area, the footprint area to the rating? I have a huge converter, power rating is very small, density is very small. 75 ampere device, full bridge, three legs of a voltage source, 30 ampere, this is 75 ampere, okay. 3 legs I need to have a separate, now this I do not have 4 ampere. Now you convert, try to make a converter, okay, wherein you require 75 ampere device. You design the converter using this and this. Now you try to find out the footprint area, the entire area of the size of the converter, okay, which will have a smaller size. So therefore, don't you think the power density in this case will be higher? So the overall size, the footprint area, the ratio of the output power to the footprint area, I can say the power density.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Can we have normal primary without tapped primary? No, normal primary in the sense without center tap. Where will I connect? Where will I connect T1 and where will I connect T2 and where is the supply voltage? You tell me. Can we have a normal primary without center tap? Somehow I have to reverse the direction of flux, both the halves of the entire BH loop in the both halves, positive first quadrant, both I need to use. Okay. If you do not have a center tap, then I may not be able to use with two switches. I may have to change the device configuration. I may have to use the device configuration. So, with normal winding, in principle, yes, but not with two switches alone. Not with two switches alone. You have to change the input stage, because if dot is positive, after some time I have to make dot as negative. I have one source. So what will you do here? It can be done. Think it over. RCPS. The question is fine. What is method to reduce, I think, dead time of switches in circuit? Method to use dead time of switches. I think I expect this is what you mean. Okay, if I have an input as a voltage source, something similar happens in the zone also. If I, these two switches are complementary, only one of them can be on. If both are on, yes, there could be a short circuit. So in other words, having turned off T1 is turned off, T2 should be turned on after some time. This is known as a dead time. This depends on the type of device. Okay. Once upon a time when we are using BJT, this could be of the order of 10 microseconds. Okay. Now if I am using IGBT of a much higher rating, then the BJT which had 10 microseconds, it could be of the order of 1 to 2 microseconds. It depends on the type of device. It depends on the type of device. There is a, in a multi-stages boosting, if you are increasing the number of stages, the efficiency becomes, efficiency reduces. What is the maximum number of stages we can apply for boosting the voltage level? I think this is what it means. I have a DC source boost 1 boost 2 and boost n, and finally he gets a higher voltage. This is VDC. This could be 7 to 7 7 times VDC, this is again whatever getting boosted, finally he will get the required voltage. Now, one is not only the efficiency, one is the number of component count. As the component count increases, reliability may come down. Reliability, if one fails, everything gone there, reliability comes down. Space, size, cost and efficiency. Now, instead you can use a transformer, okay, and depending upon the power level choose a suitable power configuration. Now, which one will you use? How many number of stages? Frankly, I have no answer. You, what is the efficiency that you can get here? What is the efficiency that you, efficiencies are not the only issue. The component count, reliability, cost. I would like to refrain from answering this question of how many stages. I would encourage you to try yourself. Okay, it's not only the efficiency, there are other issues as well. Size should be as small, as slow, small as possible. Hello sir, which range of inductor gets quickly saturated? What does it, what do you mean by which range of inductor gets quickly saturated? GCTS. Which range of inductor gets quickly saturated? What does it mean? What do you?
How to select the range of inductor, sir? How to select the range of inductors?
Now, what do you mean by how to select the range? Means what? In which converter? What you want to ask?
So whether low range or high range, like that.
Value of L, you mean?
Yes, sir. Value of L. Yes, sir.
So it all depends on the ripple. You have to say ripple on the current and the flux and the voltage. That will determine the value of C and value of L. These are the design parameters, sir. These are the design parameters. I said 5% ripple. So, depending upon the voltage and current rating, L gets fixed. DI, ripple in the current that is allowed determines the value of L. Delta I. Ripple, current ripple will determine the value of L. And again, of course, please, in flyback, value of L1 will determine the peak current. IP is given by VDC divided by L1 into D into T. This is what we derived in expression.
Manipal, over to you.
The general switching frequency adopted in these circuits, and what is the bearing on the suitable transformer core material to be selected?
Sir, about the switching frequency, I already answered, sir. I think few minutes I spent when I was talking about hot switching.
Switching frequency to adopted, and has it got bearing on the transformer core material selection in this?
Sir, say maybe around up, depends on the power level, sir. You can up to say 100 kilohertz also you can go for ferrite core. As the frequency increases, it all depends on what sort of a, what type of switching that you apply. Are you doing hard switching or soft switching? I just discussed about hard switching. We will see what happens in soft switching, what exactly you mean by soft switching. And can, or is it possible to increase the switching frequency as well? We will see in the next lecture. But often if you ask me what is the switching frequency that I can choose, sir, I am a bit hesitant to answer this question for the simple reason that if I say some figure, it may be possible, it may not be possible. It all depends on how well you are going to integrate. See, if you keep the devices, that's what I told you, when you assemble the converter or when you want to operate, when you are working on a table, everything works fine. As you try to integrate, things are not as straightforward. Whatever, that due to EMI, your base drive may get affected, it will show some spikes here and there. So product integration is not very simple. So my best, my advice is you start from a lower frequency, say a conservative figure of 10 kilohertz. If you can work at 10 kilohertz, gain sufficient confidence, then go on increasing the frequency. All of a sudden, if you say starts with 25 kilohertz, it may not be, you may not be able to design and integrate it. Let us start with a conservative figure of 10 kilohertz, find your product one cannot be, say in a sense, your prototype one cannot be the final product. Okay, there will be 3-4 stages. So first you gain enough confidence by fabricating the first prototype, start with a conservative figure of 10 to 15 kilohertz, not more than that, then slowly, slowly you increase. I can tell you from my experience, we have achieved as high as 75 kilohertz. Now, if I say operate at 75 kilohertz and you go back to your lab saying that one sir from IIT has told me to operate at 75 kilohertz, I will operate it, you may not be. So start with a very conservative, even we have started some time back, when we started with 10 kilohertz or so. We learnt from our experience. So that is my sincere request to you. Please, I don't want to throw some figure. It just doesn't make sense.
NIT Warangal, over to you.
Sir, if you want to design the control circuit, sir. So what is the procedure, sir? Because power circuit, it is not much difficult to understand, sir. But how to design a control circuit? Is it there in this particular topic? Or what is, and one more doubt regarding control circuit, sir. Suppose if we design for a, let us say, lower rating power circuit, can we use the same control circuit for higher rating power circuits also, sir?
Sir, I would think that designing a control circuit is simpler than power circuit. Anyway, what exactly you mean by control circuit? Is it a driver circuit or overall closed loop control?
Yes, sir. To turn on the switches, MOSFETs and IGBT, to turn gate on and circuit. Turn off the switches, you need to have a control circuit. Gate drive circuit, I am talking about the gate.
See, sir, gate drive circuit, BJT gate, the philosophy that I used to. Sir, okay, fine, I can understand your problem. I'll tell you two steps. One is the philosophy that we use to design the gate drive circuit for a BJT, I would explain. Almost the same philosophy for MOSFET and IGBT. I will tell you the design procedure. I will tell you the design procedure for a gate drive circuit for MOSFET as well as IGBT. I will tell you. They are not very difficult. Making a digital and analog circuit work is not very difficult. I am telling you. Okay. You can incorporate all the protections. My worry is here, you may be able to operate it, or you may be able to work on a breadboard or on a simple PCB. Okay? When you try to integrate it, you may face some problems. My sincere request to you, there are dedicated chips available, gate drive circuits. Use them. Wherein they are worried about taking care of all these EMI issues, interference issues. So main problem comes in operating DC to DC converters is not the device or not something like that, the external interference to the control circuit. If your gate drive is very stable, take it from me, you have achieved 90% success. Okay, 10% only remains. The only problem is your gate drive works sufficiently, reasonably okay at low frequencies. As you increase, because of the external interference, gate drive starts misbehaving. Okay, there are no hard and fast rule. It comes through experience, the integration. So best thing is, I encourage you need to know the philosophy. You need to know the philosophy. What is being done? There are people who have spent lot of time on. Designing and addressing all these issues. Why not use that same expertise? Okay, I would encourage you to use the gate drive circuits that are available. I can suggest the suppliers, please. The various vendors. Okay, you can get them, and try to operate, and I'll assure you that it will work. But then you need to know what may be inside. That's all. That's all. Okay. Closed loop control. I'll try to explain. See, closed loop. The structure will remain the same. Structure will remain the same. Only the gains will change. Gains will change. And the question to another question that you are asked is, I have designed the gate drive circuit, control circuit for low power. What will happen for high power? See, as the power rating increases, your device also will change. Now, if there is a MOSFET and gate to source voltage is the same, in principle, you may be able to use the same thing. You may be able to use the same thing. Okay? So, it all, one has to first choose the devices, what sort of a control circuit you want. From based on the parameters, you have to choose the control. It's not very difficult, sir. But one, we have to take first step, then things go on. One or twice device may fail, let them fail. We have to learn from our failures. Okay? That is my sincere request to you and my suggestion. I would encourage you to, instead of using discrete components to make a gate drive circuit, I will repeat, instead of using discrete components to make a gate drive circuit, there are dedicated chips are available, ASIC switches, ASIC circuits are available, use them. But understand or know the principle or whatever things are there. You may use it as a black box, but you need to know what exactly is there inside the black box. That's all. Yeah.
And sir, where can we get this control circuit, sir? And suppose if I have my own problem related to the power circuit. Suppose I own design my own control power circuit. So will the dedicated, if I have just say my problem, will the vendors can design the control circuit accordingly, sir?
Which vendors? Which vendor? No, sorry, sir, I didn't get your question. Say that again.
I think you are going to suggest some vendors to me.
No, these are dedicated chips. Dedicated chips are available. Dedicated chips are available. Dedicated chips are available.
Already existing power, or existing power circuits.
Existing gate drivers. Gate drivers. See, gate drivers, I said if you use, say for IPM, you don't need to use external gate driver. IPM, you don't need to use external, everything is built in. Now, for this also, there is no, I need to have an external gate drive, but then dedicated circuits are available. I'll bring it those dedicated circuits maybe in the next class, not today. On Monday I will bring and I'll show you what I mean. Okay, I can directly use them to drive this, or use transistors, diodes, resistors and other component capacitors to drive them. Okay, so gate drive is very important. If a gate drive is stable, I'm telling you, you have crossed a major hurdle. And in principle, don't get intimidated, take a first step and start assembling. Things may not work, things will not work, but they have to work. They have to work. Take it from me.
Sir, how will you ensure a symmetrical flux in the core?
No, I will not. You need to ensure. You need to ensure number of turns is the same, it's almost same device drops. See, small changes here and there should not affect. See, even if there is a DC flux, there are ways to address them. There are ways to address them. Flux walking can be addressed. It is there in half bridge by putting a capacitor. All those things can be addressed. That's not a problem at all. Are you with me? If there is a DC flux, or the flux, the so-called flux walking can be addressed. Literature is available. I just told you the limitations. I may not have suggested the solutions. Solutions are there. Okay. See, the problem here today, I see the big thing is to find out the problem. Having found the problem, solution can be found out. Not an issue. Not an issue.
Super, over to you.
Sir, regarding that dead time of the circuit, is it any current flowing through the circuit? Hello?
Dead time of the circuit,
sir,
any
current? Please go to the slide, sir. The practical aspects of the push-pull amplifier.
Huh? This is a push-pull? that time I mean T1 and T2 closing simultaneously, or T1 is not turned off, T2 is on. That's what I'm trying to tell.
Means we have to close the T1, we have to open the T1.
Open T1, wait for some time.
Sir, the case when the both switches T1 and T2 will be on.
If they are on, no. If they are on, you are in trouble. I am not telling you that when they are on, that is known as a dead time. No. If both are on, you are in trouble. Current is limited by the internal resistance. That is very small because these are tightly coupled and need to, you operate at a very high frequency and ensure that T1 and there is both of them do not, both of them are not on. And see, these are the timings, dt by 2 to t by 2, both T1 and T2 are off. At that time, these two diodes, D2 starts conducting, ID2 is the correct direction for the magnetizing current, because magnetizing current enter the dot here. So, magnetizing current has to enter the dot N22. So, magnetizing current will flow through, entire magnetizing current through will flow through D2, but then the remaining IL by 2 will flow through D1 and the other IL by 2 will flow through D2. Entire magnetizing current has to flow through D2 because that magnetizing current had entered the dot. So, magnetizing current has to enter the dot here. So, at that time both T1 and T2 are off. Now, it so happened that D2 has your switching duty cycle has increased, and accidentally if you close T1 and T2, you are in trouble. Current is limited by the internal resistance R. Is that okay? See, I do not, sir, it is possible to use a full bridge circuit in the primary coil of a push-pull converter. That's what I meant, yes. See, this is the push-pull, the so-called the original push-pull converter. See, the question is, instead of using a center tap and two devices in this fashion, can we use only one winding and modify the power circuit? Answer is yes. That's what I told you in the beginning, answer is yes, but I did not name the type of power circuit. So, in the literature, if you see the conventional push-pull, this is what it is. Okay? Now, instead of having two switches and a center tap winding, I can have a bridge. And connect them accordingly. Now you require four switches. Of course, you can further modify it. Go back and check, can I use half bridge? It is possible, but then now you require four switches. Whether now you decide what you want, center tap, two switches, or four switches. So that you need to decide. I am just telling you the various possibilities. The final decision is going to be yours. In principle, yes, it is possible. I can still call this as a push-pull, I do not know. But then original push-pull, if you see the textbooks or something, they named push-pull as center tap with two switches, whatever. People have modified it. This is one such modification. Thank you.